John. And shut off Spotify. All right, guys, let's get started. I think it's time. Yeah, hey, look, we're right on time. Right on time. Let's stand. Ooh, let's hear that quiet. Yeah, the air conditioner and the music's not on. Yeah. Lord, still our hearts. Lord, help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, when the world seems to be going chaotic, Lord, help us to just keep our eyes and our hearts and our souls focused in on you, Lord. And Lord, the world is definitely raging out of control, but you are sovereign and you are good and you have a perfect plan. And really what appears to us as out of control is really you're moving it to the perfect place to do the things you need to do. And so, Lord, help us to, this is the time in which you've called us to live, so help us to do what it is you want us to do and be faithful. And what you want us to do tonight is to just shut off everything and turn on to you. And so, Lord, that's what we do. We love you, Lord, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And his righteousness.
You guys can have a seat. Yeah. You get tired, sit down. That's okay. Open your Bibles to Psalm 27. Yeah, we went to a pastor's conference this last week, Monday and Tuesday, and then we just got back today. And I left before the last session started because I was wiped out. A lot of walking on hills, and I needed to get home and actually take a little nap before I came here, otherwise I wasn't going to make it. So, but Lisa and Alan, they stayed through the last session, and they had a great time. It's good. It was really good to be there. There's a lot of things that you go through your mind, but one of them is the Lord is speaking to your heart, and you hear him say certain things to you, and then all of a sudden you're hearing the exact same thing from various different speakers, and it's just confirmation that the Lord is moving you in a direction or moving this in a direction, and it's interesting. You know, there's just a few things that were a theme for the weekend, and one of the things that was a theme was our introduction in our psalm today. It was brought up by many pastors, and so I'm going to talk about some of the same things that they talked about, maybe a little differently, of course, but it's all about the condition of our world. And so it's interesting how that was put on my heart, and then I go to the conference, and you're just seeing speaker after speaker talking about the same thing. But before we get into Psalm 27, let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for the fact that you're never going to leave us nor forsake us. And Lord, this world, it looks like it's just turned upside down. Well, it is, Lord. And Lord, help us to just be faithful to do what it is you want us to do. And give us your wisdom as we navigate through these days. We love you, Lord. Give us your peace. Give us your joy. Give us your strength. And so we commit this time to you and your word. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And we all said, amen, amen. The title of the message is, My Heart Shall Not Fear. I got a little Bible there on a rock, you know, because he's the rock of our salvation. And then the sky and the blue, just that peaceful setting. Hey, my heart shall not fear. Why is that the title of the message? Because there is an awful lot of things that are going on in this world that we probably should just go, whoa, we scratch our head at, just like, this is crazy stuff. Now, I didn't watch the debate last night. I was being fed God's word and just enjoying the fellowship with a bunch of other pastors and leaders. But I heard it was kind of disastrous. And anyways, I wasn't shocked. So I don't know if I'm going to watch it later. But we are living in a dark world, aren't we? The Middle East, Russia, Ukraine, China. China's got an economic war against us. Russia and Ukraine, what's going on there? And no doubt you and I, as American citizens, we're smart enough to realize our country's right smack dab in the middle of it. You got China and Russia wanting to really reshape the world. China's threatened to take over Taiwan, and Russia's obviously going into Ukraine, and Europe is next. These guys are not good men. You know, we in America have been teaching our kids that everyone's inherently good, and you know, there's goodness. And really, the heart of man is deceitful and wicked, and these guys, you need good guys to stop bad guys, you know, and so these guys are doing what they're doing because America's weak. There's no strength in America. There's no strength in our president. There's no strength in his vice president. There's no strength whatsoever. And that's why this is happening in our culture today and in our world today is because there's no strength in America. The Middle East, October 7th, Hezbollah and Hamas, we're giving up on the one-year anniversary of that and the horrific things that took place there. If you haven't seen the videos, it's just absolutely barbaric what these people did. It's just horrible. And you see Russia, you see Turkey. Turkey is now threatening and flexing its muscles against Israel. And Iran, obviously, is the one who is leading Hezbollah and Hamas. They are funding them. And are we on the verge of a Psalm 83 Arab-Israeli war? You know, a lot of my Calvary Chapel pastor friends do not believe that Psalm 83 is still yet prophetic. I do. And so who knows? It could be very well that we could see Israel just wipe out the Arab neighbors around it, all of them, and then finally be at peace and set up the stage for Ezekiel 38 and 39. Hey, you have darkness in America. You have sexual sin running rampant in our culture. Not only running rampant, it's accepted. And if you don't accept the perversion, then there's something wrong with you. Are we in a Cold War? Are we in a full-on civil war? You know, is it right versus left? No, it's really right versus wrong. I mean, let's just be very serious. I mean, you guys know this. I'm speaking to the choir here. I'm speaking to the special forces. You guys know this. Right wing, left wing, same bird in many respects. I mean, we do the best we can at finding a candidate, you know, that's going to be closest to our standards. But, you know, my goodness, when we voted for some of these presidents in the past, Bushes, did I mention names? I mean, they were just Democrats in disguise. I mean, they were just globalists in disguise. Actually, I don't think Bush 1 was a globalist in disguise. I think he made it very clear when he came out and said the New World Order. He told us what he was about. And so, I mean, here we are trying to find the best person that we can, but it's really right versus wrong. You have globalism, whether this is under globalism or progressivism, liberalism, wokeness, whatever you want to call it, whatever this ideology is that's sweeping across our country that is actually entrenched in both sides, it's evil, and it needs to be called out for what it is. It's not, and they're taking America away from our foundation. I mean, the American culture was founded on Christian principles. You just look at the engravings upon the walls of everything down there in Washington. Harvard was a Christian college. They have scriptures on the concrete, but people just walk by it and don't even pay any attention to it. We know these things. We know that most of the signers of the Declaration of Independence were believers. Some were even pastors. And so what has happened to America? And what has happened to our Constitution? You know, one of the things I'm sorry, I don't want to pick on just one person, but I am. I'm going to pick on her. She says, I don't want to take away your guns. Well, that was a bold-faced lie.
Right.
The Democratic Party has been trying to take away the Second Amendment my entire life.
Exactly.
They've been trying to take away the First Amendment my entire life. Right. Well, you're picking on, I've picked on Republicans, I'll pick them on, I just picked on Bush. That's a bold-faced lie. She wants to de-arm the population. They want to de-arm the population. Because once they de-arm the population, now they can do whatever it is they want to do. And this is the culture we live in. Just listen to some of the headlines. Because of the immorality that's crept into our culture, because of this globalism, this wokeness, because of this immorality that's crept into our culture, you now have school shootings all over the place. We just had another one in Georgia last week, right? I just took some headlines off the news last week when I put this together. When I went to high school at Ponderosa High School, it would not be uncommon to see some guy drive up in his pickup truck with a gun rack and a gun in the back of it. No one ever shot up a school back then. Clearly, things have changed with our morals. And I know I'm preaching you guys to the choir. You go, yeah, we know, we all know. But what has happened is the immorality. There's no immorality. And you can't divorce. I mean, we're not good. And if you don't have some type of morals for our system of government, like John Adams said, then our government system is no good. And so we have to have morals. They attempted to kill the president. And I still am not optimistic that they'll ever let him in, to be honest with you. Even if he wins the election, I believe that there will be upheaval. They are entrenched, and I'm not just talking about left or Democrats, I'm talking about both. He may have some allies on the Republican side, but I don't care what anybody says. I mean, they flat out tried to kill him, and now they're flat out trying to arrest him. We have a president who sits in an empty suit, a far worse person running. These are all my notes I wrote down on Friday. And this guy, this one general says, hey, we're on the pathway towards a world war, another world's war. Texas found 95,000 non-citizens on the voter roll. 58,000 have already voted. And by the way, if you Google that, you will find Google on the first four pages refuting that finding. This is the cover-up that's taking place. By the way, Mark Zuckerberg actually admitted that they did cover up the Democrats' request to the Hunter laptop and all that stuff. And this is what's taking place. Another headline on Friday read, the S&P falls 1% Friday, heads for the worst week in a year on tech selling. Weak job report. By the way, the job report is very weak. Listening to Tom Sullivan on Friday, and he says, man, this is not good news, and the media is covering it up. Inflation is out of control. Interest rates are out of control. And you know, by the way, one of the things that was so striking to me with some of the things that guys were saying to me is that back in 2020, after the first debate, and I just sensed that the Lord was saying this to me. Look, I'm not saying thus saith the Lord, and this is how I prefaced it back in 2020, that God is removing his hand from America, and that I believe he's judging it. And I believe we're getting what he is allowing us to have. Just like Israel got Saul, we too are getting what, you know, you go down a path so long and God is so patient and so gracious, eventually he says, you know what, I'm going to give you up to it, in Romans 1 is what he says. And so you look at this, and I said that. By the way, when I said that, I got so much flack. Oh, you're so negative. Look, we got to keep fighting. I mean, nowhere in here am I saying we quit fighting. We fight on our knees. We fight in prayer. We fight in preaching the gospel. That's the main priority. We preach the cross. That is the main way we fight. But there's also okay to say, you know, we're going to stand up for righteousness in a culture, just like Paul did when he wrote Romans 1, in a culture that was very much just like ours, entrenched in sexual perversion. We stand up, and we try to be salt and light as best we can in this culture. Sadly, the church has become woke itself, as we all know here in this room, and they're afraid to even address certain topics like what I'm saying today. And that's why it was so refreshing to me to hear speaker after speaker after speaker at the conference yesterday and Monday and Tuesday and yesterday was Tuesday. Sorry, a little tired, but they were saying some of the exact same things I'm saying, a little bit different, of course, but I could tell you there was some guys probably in that room that I know of that would bristle at the fact that they were even talking like that. And they would say, oh, no, we can't bring that to the church. Well, no, we need to bring it to the church. We need to expose evil. That's what it tells us to do, expose it, to shine the light of truth on it. And so we do that. But then we also need to understand that this stuff is taking place in the church. The church is crumbling. We need revival. We need to be in prayer. That's why we pray all the time here. That's why we have so many prayer meetings. We need to be encouraged, too. We could talk about it. This is not a negative thing. We need to be encouraged, too, because God is with us, and God is for us, and we're going to prevail. So in light of all this, how do we live? We live in the victory that Jesus has given us. We live in the joy of the Lord, and the joy of the Lord is what? Our strength, is it not? And we have the words of life, and we must share those words with a dying, lost world. We must also remember that none of this is taking the Lord by surprise. As a matter of fact, he told us that it's going to happen. He told us. He said, hey, in the end times, people aren't going to stand for sound doctrine. In the end times, they're going to be lovers of selves, proud, boastful. You know, go to 1 Timothy. He's told us what to expect. But we can live in victory. You and I can live at peace. You and I can look at this situation, and yeah, we need to be engaged and connected, but we can also look at it with a sense of detachment because this is not our home, right? We're just pilgrims and sojourners passing through. And there's no accident, just like in Esther, it says, for such a time as this, we have been placed here. So we need to be victorious. We need to know that we fight not for victory, but from victory. We need to just stand and be salt and light. And we need to live as if Jesus is coming back in the next 10 seconds. And we need to live if he's not coming back for 1,000 years. And we need to just keep being faithful with the day-to-day task. And so in this psalm, the word psalm, let's get a little bit of an introduction to the book of Psalm. Just the word psalm in the Hebrew actually means praise. And I was going to try to pronounce it. Well, I'll try to pronounce it. Tehillim. Okay, I just butchered it, and I wasn't speaking in tongues, I promise, but it means praise. There you go. That's the English word. I can handle praise. I can't handle the Hebrew word. The Greek word means a poem sung to musical accompaniment or, in particular, stringed instruments. Stringed instruments. The book of Psalm is a hymn book of God's people, music for the soul. Music touches the soul. It touches the emotions. Have you ever just sat down? I mean, I know you guys all have. You've done this. You know, just a few weeks ago, I just sat down and literally was worshiping almost all day. And that song that we sung, Grace, I can't remember the title of it, but the City of Lights sings it. And I heard that song. I mean, it just touched the very depth and the core of my life because I needed a fresh outpouring of his grace, a fresh outpouring of his love and his mercy in my life. And there it was at the moment I needed it. He was faithful to give it to me. And I know you guys have all experienced similar things as that as well. But that's what music does. It does. It has a way of getting into the very depth of who we are. I mean, how is it that we can all remember a song from 50 years ago, but we can't remember somebody's name we just met 5 minutes ago, right? I mean, one of the things we were doing at one point, goofing off around a dinner table or lunch table, is there was a man named Jed. Let me tell you a story. And I said, about a man named Jed? And then we go, oh, poor mountaineer, barely kept his family fit. And then everyone was chiming in on the song. I mean, are you kidding me? Are we watching too much TV or what? But that's what songs can do. They get stuck in our hearts and in our heads. And then if they're good, they're good songs. And they can go deep and they can affect us emotionally. And that's what the book of Psalms is all about. It's really a book of him because it's all about Jesus. Now, Psalm 27, that's a great psalm. I mean, it's one of my favorites. It's up there with Psalm 51. It's up there with Psalm 1, Psalm 23. I mean, there's just so many great psalms. It's hard to just grab one, but it's up there. I'm telling you, it's up there because of times like this in which we live, in which it seems to be so disparaging and so depressing. But the circumstances behind this psalm, we're not 100% sure. But I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm not going out on too far of a limb because other people have suggested this as well. But I believe it's 1 Samuel 23. Now, we know the context of David's life. David was just minding his own business, out there tending his sheep. When Samuel comes and says, "You're the next king of Israel," what? He's like happy. And now all of a sudden his life radically changes. It starts off great. He kills Goliath. And everyone thinks he's a star. And then all of a sudden Saul turns on him. And then all of a sudden he's with Saul and he's hanging out with Saul and Saul's throwing spears. I mean, that's Saul knew how to do one thing really well, and that was throw spears, right? And so David's in exile. David was in exile for a total of maybe 10 or 15 years. He's running from Saul. He's running for his life. He's not quite sure who to trust, how to trust. He was actually married to Saul's daughter, Michal, and that he had to separate from her. And so his life is just turned upside down completely. He's being slandered. And then you come to 1 Samuel 23, and you guys remember that. The people of Keilah were being attacked by the Philistines, and David asked the Lord, "Should I go help?" "Yeah, you should go help." And he goes and helps. And then when he helps and he defeats the Philistines, the people of Keilah betray him and turn him over to Saul, or try to turn him over to Saul, and he's running for his life. So he's got a lot of highs and a lot of lows in his life, but this is a very low moment in his life, and so he's looking for hope. And you and I are also looking for hope, and that's why my heart shall not fear. There are 3 points that we're going to look at tonight, and the first one is the hope of the believer, the hope of the believer. Look at verses 1 through 3. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army encamped against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident." And so what's David doing here is he's reminding himself of the promises of God. And this is a wonderful thing for us to do in light of the world that we live in today, is to remind ourselves of the promises of God. The gates of hell will never prevail against the church. That God has got a perfect plan, and he's moving this world to where it needs to be for the final conclusion. And I believe we're getting close to that. But let's look at these first three verses here, break it down a little bit. The first thing I want you to recognize in verse 1 is how many times he uses "my." You see, it's there 3 times. And in this case, it's good. You know, not like my mind, like the seagulls in Finding Nemo. My. No, he's actually saying "my light, my salvation, my strength." It actually is speaking of something that is intimate. He has an intimacy with God. He has a connection with God. And guys, we need this because he is our light. He is our salvation. He is our strength. We need to make sure that we have a deep and growing personal relationship with him. And it has to be growing. You don't want it to get stale. And, you know, there's times where, like on Monday night, there was a little afterglow, and I'm praising the Lord and singing, and I'm hearing from the Lord. And I just, several times I just said, "Lord, I hear you. I hear you. I heard you. I heard you again. I heard you again." Because there's an intimacy there. And I'm not just making these things up. It's not like I'm just kind of pulling things out of the air and just kind of imagining things. No, it's a genuine, he's actually confirming things that he put on my heart. And then somebody says something, or I hear something, or it's like it triggers it. Okay, I got it. That's confirmation. Thank you. Because there's an intimacy. I spend time with him. I spend time with his word. And David is saying, I have an intimacy with God. And we need to make sure that we're always growing in that. You know, we can have the deepest, most intimate relationship with him. It's deeper than any other human relationship can ever be. Deeper than a husband to a wife, or deeper to a son to a father, deeper to a friend to a friend. It's the deepest, most intimate relationship we can have. And I just encourage us to continue to grow in that and keep feeding that in light of what we see taking place in our culture today. Just keep growing more in love with Jesus. Amen. Keep reading the Word. Turn off the news. I was so glad, actually, when I found out the debate was on Tuesday and I'm going to be sitting listening to a Bible study and I couldn't get away. I didn't want to get away. I was like, okay, well, no, you know. Look, it's a train wreck. I know it's hard to stop taking your eyes off a train wreck. Have you ever seen something that's like, oh, that's horrible to see? But, like, you still keep looking. Oh, Lord, just pray. It's the best thing we can do is pray, but let's keep growing in love with Jesus. Amen. We have a greater hope. We do. We have a greater hope. God who created the universe, He is our God. He is our refuge, and He is our hiding place. You know, do you have a Bible that honestly, and I'm not trying to boast or brag, do you have a Bible? Actually, you know, I just did this today to make it look like I use it. I've taken pictures before. They go, what do you got, an addiction to a yellow highlighter? You're only supposed to highlight the ones that are really impactful. Well, they are. Well, yeah. I mean, right? So there's whole pages at a time. There's like, you know, you get to the New Testament, you know, Colossians 3. It's like all every highlight. So I underline too, and then I write, you know, and like, anyways, just a Bible where you just sit. And some of my greatest time in studying, guys, is not the time of technical digging in and looking at Greek words or you know, just finding out what this guy says or that guy says. Some of my greatest times is just sitting there in the beginning and reading the text over and over and over and over and over. And I just let it say, Lord, what is this saying? Before I hear anybody else's voice, what do you want me to hear? I'm underlining, I'm highlighting, I'm going, oh, that's interesting, and I'm asking questions to the text. I talk to the text. I'm a little weird. Okay, a lot weird. Okay, my son thinks I'm really crazy, certifiable. Let's put him up in the, you know. Judy's kind of halfway on the fence with that. No, I mean, you guys all get it. I mean, one day I was sitting there in the house. Judy can testify this just a couple of weeks ago. And I just said, I love you, Lord. Right? I just said it out loud. I love you, Lord. And she thought I was going to say, I love her. Love you. But I was focused on the Lord for a bit. I go, I love you, Lord. So then I had to turn around and tell her, of course, I loved her. So it's just grow, guys, grow. Let me just encourage you, grow in these last days. Make reading the Bible, make prayer, make church a huge responsibility to be in fellowship with one another as best we can. And stay connected to the fire pit, amen. And then number two, let's look at verse 1 again. The Lord is my light, my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And David's come a long way as a humble shepherd boy, facing giants, fighting battles. But through it all, he's recognized that God is his provision. God is his portion. God is everything he needs. And he makes these declarations that the Lord is my light. Light speaks of freshness. It speaks of illumination. It speaks of clarity. It speaks of understanding. I don't know about you, but I love light. One of the things that the speakers brought up this last week is, you know, these people who build these caves or these tunnels and they have food for 6 months and they're going to try to outlive. Listen, I'm not going into a bomb shelter. Just tell me where the bomb's coming, and I'm going to move closer to it. Because when I die, I'm going to be in the presence of light that'll never go dim. The thought of being underground in some bunker for 5 months, 5 minutes even, 5 seconds even, well, maybe 5 seconds I can handle. Why do I want to live like that? I mean, gee, we got these big windows at John and Sharon's house. They're so gracious to let us rent. And I mean, I love those big ones. Now, sometimes in the summer months, that sun's coming in too bright. But I just love, you know, opening up the windows and letting the light just come in. And even if it's cloudy and foggy and there's still light, the sun is still illuminating its light. Darkness is kind of nice because you can walk out there and then you can look up at the stars that are illuminating the light from the sun. And you're just going, oh, this is kind of a cool thing too. But boy, I love light. You know, in John 1:5, it says the light shines in the darkness and the darkness doesn't comprehend it. And that's us, you and I, him. We're shining in the darkness and the darkness doesn't understand us. That was the true light, he says in verse 9, which gave light to every man coming into the world. David recognized that God is light, meaning that God is salvation, God is clarity, God is peace, God is hope, God is everything we need. And God is light. And so when you look through the Old Testament, you'll see there's a reference to God, his word being light. In the New Testament, you see directly. And so God is light. Evil is always referred to as darkness. And wherever you see darkness, you see confusion. And wherever you see confusion, you see evil. Just remember that. When you see confusion, you see evil. When you see people bringing clarity and bringing light to a situation, good. When you see people trying to muddy the water, that's evil. That's darkness. Run away from it. Where there's division, where there's bitter envy, self-seeking in your heart, do not boast and lie against the truth, James says in James chapter 14. And he goes on and says, this wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of the righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. And so let's just stay away from darkness. Let's stay away from the bitter envy, the self-seeking, and lying against the truth. And then he says, God is salvation. Obviously, David's offenses that we know of, boy, did he mess up when he went into the Philistine territory the second time. Boy, did he mess up when he had an affair, or committed adultery, with Bathsheba. Boy, did he really mess up when he murdered Uriah. And all of our sins are capital offenses too, meaning that we deserve death for our sins, eternal separation from God. And this right here, in light of what's going on in our world, should just make us beam with joy. But God stepped out of eternity and saved us from our sins by dying on the cross. He gave us salvation. And since we have salvation, we have his grace, we should celebrate. You know, one of the things the Lord put on my heart the other day was my life is a testimony of his grace. David's life was a testimony of God's grace. All of our lives are a testimony of God's grace. My life to this point is a testimony of his grace. My life going forward will be a testimony of his grace. My life in eternity forever will be a testimony to his grace. To his grace, to his salvation. Rejoice in that. Rejoice in that instead of being depressed about the circumstances in our world. Hey, the Lord is the strength of his life. He is our strength, is he not? He is our strength. He's our strong tower. He's the rock in which we stand. He is everything we need. The strength. He's the source. You're weak, you're feeble, you know where to plug into. When your phone starts losing battery charge, what do? You plug it into the strength. You plug it into the source, and it gets charged, and it's ready to go again. And that's what we got to do. We got to go to the strength. And we got to remember that with God being our strength, that there is some promises that he has. In Matthew 26, 19, 26, it says this, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And then Ephesians 3, 20 says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works within us, he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can even ask. And so, Lord, I ask that you would save America in the sense that you would save Americans, which would bring revival, which would then save America, which would then allow this world to maybe live a little bit longer before it destroys itself. But every one of those speakers that we had at the conference says, short of revival, America has no hope. And so we need a revival. But Pastor Lance hit us between the eyes, because we'll all say we need a revival, right? But do we really know what that means? Because revival means that there's repentance. Revival means that it gets messy. Revival means that it starts with you and me. And we might even shake our heads to that. But what is it that might be lurking in our hearts that needs to be away, that needs to be confessed, that needs to be repented from, and needs to be turned from? I mean, we could sit there and say about revival, 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 but be living contrary to the word of God in our own personal lives. So would you revive us first, please, Lord? Revive us. And if you've stumbled and fallen, He will revive you if you repent and confess and earnestly seek his face. And then he says in the last part of verse 1, of whom shall I be afraid? Listen, I've got the Lord on my side. There is no fear. No fear. No fear. You know, one of the things, you know, you're laying on the asphalt and it's 2,000 degrees outside, which is to me anything over 70. It's 70, Jeff. No, it's 2,000 degrees, guys. At least that's what I feel. I don't know what's going on. You know, you go to the hospital and they say, you know, we've got to make sure that broken pelvis isn't life-threatening. We've got to get in there. What? Huh? What are you talking about, Willis? Make sure that it doesn't affect your organs. Okay. Yeah. But I was at complete peace. Complete peace. Matter of fact, I was kind of like going, wow, this wouldn't be a bad way to go. I'm just kidding. It was a bad way. It hurt. But, I mean, it was like, okay, I'm already here, so just go ahead and finish it off. You know, just let's go. But I wasn't afraid of anything. I wasn't afraid of anything. Not one thing, because I had the Lord with me. And I could face whatever was there. Although I am, you know, Judy wanted to go on vacation, so she booked a cruise. I got to tell you, I'm a little fearful. I don't understand how metal floats. And you're in the middle of the ocean, and you can't see land. Okay, is this weird?
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, you know, I've talked to other people who go, just go inside, you won't even know, right? Okay, all right, no, I'll still know. Every night I'm going to sleep, this metal is floating. How's this happen? This shouldn't be happening. Anyways, but no, I won't fear. I don't want to drown and get eaten by a shark. So, no, but I won't. I'm not. I'm just kind of joking. But let's move on to verse 2. Otherwise, we're never going to finish. When the wicked came against me, to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Mm-hmm. And so he obviously here, David is revealing times when defeat seemed certain, but God came through. Yeah. Doesn't it seem like America is almost defeated for sure? I mean, honestly, I like to be optimistic, and I thank God for my optimistic friends because they keep me going in the right direction. Because everything to me right now is just like Chicken Little. The sky is falling. But David has had his back against the wall and God's come through. You know what? God can still come through. Especially if his church would humble themselves and if they would repent and get into prayer. Every great revival has started with prayer. Every great revival has started with prayer. And prayer is work. It's work. And God will do the same for us. If we just keep seeking after him and keep praying, who knows? Who knows what God will do? Verse 3, though an army encamped against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. He was a man of war, wasn't he? But he had learned to trust the Lord in every situation. In every situation. Every situation. And you and I need to learn to trust him in every situation. God is bigger than the battles we face. We must never forget this. He is bigger than what's taking place in America. We must never forget that. You turn on Fox News and all you hear is the sky is falling, the sky is falling. But know this, God is bigger than that. By the way, don't watch Fox either, just as much as you shouldn't watch any of the others. Just read. You know, we are prone, as Spurgeon said, to engrave our trials in marble and write our blessings in sand. So we should really learn to understand that God has come through in times past just like David did. You know, I had some kind of conversations over the week in which, you know, sometimes you worry. You know, especially after this last accident, you know, you worry. You know, physically, you know, we're in a culture where church is not popular. Especially if you're preaching the word and you know, how are you going to make a living one day if you can't have a body, it's all broken up and you can't do anything physical anymore. And you're like, you start to take your eyes sometimes off of the fact that God has never yet failed me. And why do I think he's going to fail me tomorrow? Why is it that we all do that? Well, I know you got me through the last 2 billion situations that I was in, but this is different this time. I'm getting old. I'm approaching that old age of 60, and you guys are going, man, I wish I was 60 again. Some of you guys are going like 60, man. And then And then you have the accident, you're hurting inside, and you go, oh, man. But you do, you have this tendency, everybody does. I'm just sharing intimate feelings. You just have a temptation to take your eyes off the Lord and to look at the circumstances and to look at the armies and to look at the enemies. But David had learned to trust the Lord in the battles, and so do we. And he will be there for the next one, and he will be there for the next one, and he'll be there for the next one. God will always come through, amen. So one of the things we should do is maybe probably what Joshua did when they came across the Jordan and set up the memorial stones and set up little reminders of what God has done for us so that when we see them, we remember, you know what? That was 1985, and look at how he was faithful. Oh, that was 1996, and look at that. He's come through again. And then look at that. That was 2001. And oh, man, he really came through that time, didn't he? Yeah, to set those up. Remember, he can move mountains. Remember, he calmed the storms. Remember, he fed a bunch of people with just a few pieces of bread and a few fish. He's good. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again. The older I get in the Lord, one of the things that I'm just completely, well, his grace is obviously at the top of the list, but his goodness. Guys, his goodness. His goodness is just blaring more and more in these days as I get older in the Lord. All right, verse 4, and we're looking at the next main point, which is the heart of the believer. And he says, one thing I've desired of the Lord is that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. So there are three things that we see about David's heart here, and the first one is he has a heart of wisdom, because the one thing that does the heart of wisdom says is, you know what, I'm going to seek the Lord. I desire the Lord that I will seek him. He could have said, I need more victories. He could have said, I need a larger kingdom. He could have said, I need more wealth or power. I need more glory days. But he says, no, I'm going to seek you first. Wisdom says I'm putting God first. I'm not worried about these other things. I'm putting him first. And wisdom must put God first. And we must put God first. He can't take a backseat to anything in our life. He must be number one. Is he our first thought in the morning and our last thought at night? And does he fill the majority of our days? I hope he does. Many Christians live defeated lives because they desire things from the Lord, but they don't really desire the Lord himself. And we need to desire the him. Not that we can't take our cares and our burdens to him. We absolutely can. But we need to seek him and seek his face first and seek him, to see him. God has given himself completely to us. And I heard a pastor once saying, we have all of God that we want. So if you don't have enough of God, it's not his problem, it's our problem. We have resisted him in some way. And so seek him first. The heart of a man is seeking after God first like David did. And may we continue to do that in the days we live. That I may dwell. Where does he want to dwell? In the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Yeah, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord. I want to be with the Lord. I want to be in worship. You know, if I had one complaint, and I was actually talking to Pastor Bob about this morning before we left, and I said, if I had one complaint about this conference, yeah, what would it be? We need another day. And he goes, you would never have enough days. I said, I know, but let's just add another day, you know? Because when you're together like that, I mean, and it's at the conference, and have you guys been to Mount Hermon? Oh, my gosh, yeah, it is amazing. Is it not amazing? Yeah. I mean, it's amazing. And we're there eating breakfast in the morning, coffee, breakfast, and then we're at study after study after study, worship after worship after worship, prayer after prayer after prayer, and then you kind of go to bed, you get up, you do the same thing the next day. I mean, who doesn't want to do that every day? I know we got to come down the hill and we got to work, right? But boy, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever, and I want that worship, that to be a part of my life, no matter where I'm at, whether I'm in Mount Hermon on the mountain enjoying that time, or I'm actually in the trenches doing the work. I want to have that heart that's always worshiping the Lord. And I do have a huge desire to be in his house, in his temple, in the future and even today. You know, one of the things that when we felt the call from the Lord, to be in ministry is that we were just at church every second we could be at church. Every second we were there. They had to hire me. I wouldn't go home. What are you going to do with this guy? Well, we better put him on staff. And so there I am, getting on staff. And I got to tell you, honestly, I don't know. I may do this if Judy ever passed away before me. Put a bed in the back. Hey, guys on the board, I need a shower in here. let's get a set. And then I'm set. Got a refrigerator, got a stove, got food. Come by, spend any time you want. And never go home. Well, this is home.
This is home,
right? Yeah. And then the last part of verse 4, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Is the Lord not beautiful? Mm-hmm. You know, in America, we put beauty on things like how our outside looks, right? I gave up trying to look good a long time ago. Let's just stay clean. You know? Some of you guys were blessed with some great looks, okay? All of you guys, I guess, you know, I don't know what happened to me. He says, hey, the good-looking department line, and I must have, I don't know what he said, you know, but I was in the wrong line. But that's what we think is real beauty, isn't it? We think it's outward, and that's why there's millions of dollars spent on cosmetics and on fashions and stuff like that. But do you know the word beauty actually means kindness, pleasantness, delightfulness, favor? Nothing about the outside. It's all about the inside. And that's where real beauty is. Hey, our Lord was not, when he was here, would not considered beautiful by Madison Avenue. He must have gotten in the wrong line too. It says in Isaiah 53 that, for he shall grow up before him a tender plant and a root out of dry ground. And he had no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and he was not esteemed. And the only man-made marks in heaven are going to be the marks that we put on Jesus, making that beauty even more marred, but it's actually going to be more beautiful for us to see it. On a physical level, you're going to be, oh, but on a spiritual level, you're going to look at it and go, oh, yeah. Yeah. I heard a story once of a little kid who was out by the pond, and the mom saw an alligator quickly approaching this child who must have been 5 or 6, 7, somewhere in there. The alligator got a hold of his legs at the same time she grabbed his arms. And she was trying desperately to pull the little child away from the alligator with his arms and her hands. And finally somebody came by and saw some rancher, got off his tractor and came and was able to kill the alligator and separate the child from the alligator. And he was in the hospital recovering. And a news reporter was asking him about the scars on his legs and the scars on his hands. And he says, are you embarrassed about the scars on your hands? Are you ashamed? He goes, no, I'm going to look at these scars for the rest of my life and realize how much my mom loved me. Well, you and I are going to look at the scars on Jesus for eternity, and we're going to realize how much he loved us. That's the real beauty, is it? Not. Is the scars on him. Verse 5, and we're going to look at the hiding place of the believer with the remaining time. And in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. And in the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon the rock. All right, so he's going to hide us in his pavilion. You guys know what the king's pavilion was? It was a tent that had been erected in the middle of the army's camp. And it was protected by valiant soldiers. So you have a camp that's, you know, Israel may be going to battle, and then you have the king's pavilion, which is in the middle of the army, protected by the mightiest of soldiers from the enemy. And that's what it means to be in his pavilion, is that we are in his camp, protected by him. So regardless of where this world goes, deny Jesus or die, we are in his pavilion. We are being protected, not necessarily the physical, but the spiritual. The soul will be protected. We are in his pavilion. We will be protected by him. And then he says in verse 5b, in the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. The secret place. It speaks of the Holy of Holies where God dwelt. It speaks of an inner place. It speaks of a place that only a few have entered. It speaks of a place as children of God can dwell in a secret place where we can enjoy God's presence. Do you have a secret place in these dark days in which you can run? I can find that place in a nanosecond anywhere I'm at. Anywhere. Anywhere at any time. It's amazing. I'm laying on the asphalt. I find that secret place with God right there. I'm in the hospital, in the x-rays, or the what are those things called? Those CAT scans or whatever they are. I'm in that inner place with God. That secret place. I'm praying. I'm with him. He's with me. At home. Wherever. I'm in God's secret place. A place where it's just him and it's just me and the world is gone. A place where I can rest and trust and know that I have his love, I have his grace, I have his hope, I have his peace. And then he goes on to say in verse 5 that he shall set me high upon the rock, which means stability. You know, I was told early on, you know, when I moved over here that the foothills are, you know, they're built on rocks. And then all you have to do is try to plant a lawn and you'll find out that that's absolutely true. It's built on rocks. And because it's built on rocks, we're not as susceptible to earthquakes like the coast is. And so we have the benefit of being in a pretty secure place for earthquakes. Now, that's not to say we're immune to them, but we are. Most of us, I'm sure, in the foothills don't have earthquake insurance because it's too expensive and we're not necessarily in a spot like San Francisco or Southern California where we would need to have it. But if it does happen, it'll be a disaster, of course, but you guys get the idea of what I'm saying. The rock is a place of strength and stability. And he has set us high upon that rock. Elsewhere in the Psalms, it says he took us out of the miry pit and placed us on the rock. It speaks of a place of safety and security. And then verse 6, he lifted. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I shall offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Oh, man. David had enjoyed victory over his enemies. He was being lifted up in a lofty position. And this is what God does when we sing praises to his name. He lifts us up with him. You know, we may lose some battles on this planet, but we're ultimately victorious in Christ. So lift up your voice and praise to him. Sing his praises. Sing them loud. Let the music touch your soul. Look, everyone's different. I mean, I get it. We're all different. You know, some are more outgoing in regards to worshiping the Lord. Some are very still and stoic, but in the inside there is a deepness and a depth to it. However you do it, just make sure you're doing it to the Lord and you're just singing those praises out as with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, and with all your soul. And thank him for what it is that he's done in our hearts. Thanksgiving to God will help us get through these rough days. It is interesting, isn't it? I mean, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? I mean, we're in some weird times. Banana Republic weird times. But we can always praise the Lord no matter what. Verse 7, hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. So here he is, he's like David, you know, the Lord has answered him probably many times, but he's like that next time, he goes, I don't think he's going to answer me this time. So he said, hear me when I cry. Hear me when I cry. And he does hear us. He hears us when we cry. And he will answer us. He will. And when you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. And then he goes on to say, when my father and my mother, that when would better be translated, if my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will care of for me. His father, we don't know of his mother and father ever forsaking him, but what he's speaking of there is that even if my most intimate relationships on this planet forsake me, you are there to take care of me. And then when he talks about seeking his face, this is the thing that has just been, it just in my heart. And it was funny because the first day we were there, you kept hearing, seek his face, seek his face, seek his face. And that was another confirmation that the Holy Spirit's working in you know, and I'm hearing him, and others are hearing. It is in this time and season in which we live in this world, we need to seek his face more than ever before. We need to be in prayer like never before. And we need to be in corporate prayer like never before. Look, we put it out there. I can't make people come to prayer. You know, we have the men praying this afternoon. We have the Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. And we have Sundays, the House of Prayers, twice a month. And quite frankly, sometimes on the House of Prayers, there's a little attendance. And you feel as a pastor, well, maybe this is just something we should just let go. And then I started praying about that the other day. And the Lord says, no, you will not let it go. Even if it's just you and they're praying. Okay, Lord. I'll stay faithful to your task. And you'll bring the people when you feel led to bring the people. And if you don't, then it'll just be a great time of prayer with you and me. But I've never been alone. Not yet, but I doubt I will be. But we need to seek him before the gifts, guys. Like, okay, bring your prayer request. Absolutely bring your prayer request before the Lord. But, you know, Vic has that saying that he got from J. Vernon McGee that sometimes we just need to go in the closet and just shut up and hear him. You know, he already knows what we need. You give him a couple of minutes of, here's, Lord, my request, but I'm going to sit here and tell me what I need. You tell me what I need to hear. Not what I want you to do, but what I need to hear from you. And we need to do that. And then, guys, another thing that's so critical to me that was so special to this is because we need to be seeking him before working. Martha was too busy working. Mary was doing the right thing, which was actually needful. And so many times, especially in the ministry, I'm not saying it can't happen to you too, but my illustration would come from a ministry point of view, is that you get so busy doing the good stuff in the ministry. I'll get to you, Lord. I'll get to you. 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 And then times go by, seasons go by, and you haven't spent the time you should be, which is actually needful for the work of the ministry. And it's the same with you, wherever you may be working. You can't go to work in your own power and your own strength. You've got to make sure you have that time in prayer in the morning. Look, I know the world is yelling at us that they need it yesterday, right? And God is saying, tell them to shut up. I'm sorry, I'm just putting it in some modern terms. He told Israel to take a Sabbath. Taking a Sabbath means I got to stop work. I can't plow the field. I can't do this. I can't do that. I can't do that. How are we going to make it? How are we going to make it? Are you going to trust me? Yeah, I'm going to trust you. So seek him first and trust him. The customer will either be there or he won't be there. You know, I've never gone in to buy a car or any other thing like that, and the guy's trying to push me to buy it today because, you know, it won't be here tomorrow. Well, good, then it wasn't God's will. God had another plan for me. I guess I don't need that one. What do you mean? What do you mean? Why don't you test drive it? Because once you test drive it, we know that you won't walk out of here without wanting to buy it. You know, so my wife and I are going, if I start to get soft and want to have it before, you know. No, I mean, you know what I'm saying? You got to seek him. Seek him. And don't let the world pressure you into moving past seeking him first. And I'm going to be very candid with you guys. When my aunt died in November, from November to June, I felt like I was more of a worker than a worshiper. And I confessed in June, and I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I could sense it in my own soul, my own spirit. I've gotten off track, and I'm just working, and I'm not worshiping. And would you forgive me? And I need to spend more time in worship. And we all need to spend more time seeking his face. Amen. And he's not going to leave us. He's not going to forsake us. And so this relationship that he had with his mother and father, we have no record of them ever leaving him. But I think a better translation, like I said, would be F. And David is saying, if my most intimate relationships leave me in my life, then I know that I will be okay because you are still with me. Listen, one of the pastors up there said, it's a great thing when you see your children walking with the Lord. And it is the most horrific thing in the world when you see them not walking with the Lord. To which I said a huge amen. It is the most deepest pain you can experience, in my humble opinion. even if you lost a son and they were saved, that would be a tremendous pain, don't get me wrong. But this knowledge that they could die outside of Christ, I'm telling you, it hurts in a way that it keeps me up at night sometimes praying for them. But I know this, although they may have forsaken us, God will never forsake us. And God loves me and God cares for me. And that's what David is saying. And like the prodigal father, you look through the window every day thinking this may be the day they come home. And then he goes on to say in 11, teach me your ways, O Lord. He's wanting to know the ways of the Lord. He's wanting to know his word. He's wanting to be in the will of God. And then he says, lead me in the smooth path because of my enemy. Now, we got to understand this word smooth path here. He's not praying for an easy life. Really, what the word is reflecting is that he's looking for a smooth path to stand on, to grab a strong footing to face the enemy. That's what it says there. Because of my enemy. So, Lord, when I face my enemy, it'd be a whole lot better for me to face him on a platform that is smooth versus all this unstable ground that I could possibly be on. Because then I have the full power of my ability to face my enemy. And some quarterback, when he sees that there's rain in the forecast for Sunday, he's praying, Lord, let it be dry so I don't have to try to pick up a wet football to face my enemies. I mean, you guys get what I'm saying with that analogy? Lord, he's not saying, I want an easy life. He's saying, make sure that I have a strong path in which to stand on as I face the battles in life. And do not deliver me. By the way, if you want, let me just go back to easy life. We all want an easy life to some degree. And that's the American dream, right? We work 20, 30 years, retire, buy a boat. I understand the two good days in a boat owner's life. There's two great days when they buy a boat. The day they buy it and the day they sell it. But I don't know if that's true. I've never bought a boat. They watch all these HGTV shows. Oh, I could buy a boat, and we could do this, and we could do that. I just think, man, all this stuff you buy, you got to take care of and you worry about. But anyways, that's the American dream, is ease. But God says, no, my path is not easy. It's going to be mixed with struggles and trials. You don't grow in times of ease. You grow in times of struggle. Verse 12, do not deliver me to the will of my adversary, for false witnesses have risen against me, and such as breathe out violence. And then he goes on and says, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And this is an interesting verse. First of all, in the original manuscripts that we have, and they're not original, but the manuscripts that we have, we got to understand, and please understand this. I know, well, don't talk about these things. You confuse people. No, you're Bible students. You can handle this. I would have lost heart is not in the originals that we have. Somebody has added it. It doesn't mean it's wrong. It actually makes the verse make sense. So there's nothing wrong with that, but we got to understand I would have lost heart is not in, and you may have, I may not, I would have fainted, or what do you mean? I don't know what other translation you have. But if you notice it in italic, if you have a King James or New King James, the italic means that it's not in the manuscripts that we, the oldest manuscripts that we have. Unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land. Now, what does that mean? Well, that's an interesting question, isn't it? There are those who believe in dominion theology that believe that we are actually going to usher in a goodness in our world prior to the Lord coming. And so maybe that's the goodness of the land, you know, the Lord. They're going to see this goodness in the land, and then the Lord will come. Well, dominion theology does not match the scriptures anywhere. Everything we see in regards to scriptures, it says, man, people are going to get worse in the last days, not better. So dominion theology is really a false religion. This world is not going to get better. It may get better for a little while and then go through another cycle, just like Israel did. They were up, and then they were down. Then they were up, and they were down. But it's not going to get better until he's here. So does the goodness of the land of the living mean that when he comes and actually rules and reigns in the millennial kingdom? Some think that. Some think that it refers to the promise that David had from God, that he was going to see the God's goodness in the land. He was going to get through this trial, and he would be king, and he would one day enjoy what God had told him he would enjoy. That's a good translation, too. Some say the land of the living is clearly not speaking of earth, but heaven. So some people say that the land of the living is actually when he goes to heaven. And Spurgeon and others have made the point that there's actually more graves than there are people alive today. There's more graves than there are houses. There's more graves on earth. This isn't the land of the living. This is actually the land of the dead. And the dying. I believe it could be all these things. But I know this, that the world is not going to get better. It's going to get worse. And the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living is the presence of God in our life today and the future hope that we have in him. Verse 14, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he shall renew your strength. Wait, I say, on the Lord. And again, we talked about this word wait in times past, but this wait is a wait with anticipation that God is going to do something incredibly good. He will. Again, you know, you're praying for a loved one who's dying in the hospital, and you're waiting on the Lord to answer that prayer. He may not answer it with the, you know, that loved one surviving. But if they know Christ, he answered it in a different way. He allowed them to finish their race and take them home. The wait on the Lord knows that it may not happen on this earth, but it's going to happen in eternity. And so whatever happens in this world, whether good or bad, I have God with me, and I can be of good courage, and I will strengthen my heart, and I will continue to wait on him, and I will continue to look to him no matter what takes place here on this planet. Whether the most intimate relationships in the world separate from me, whether the vice president becomes president, oh, Lord, have mercy on America. Whether Russia takes over Ukraine, I just know God's got a perfect plan. And I know that he wants us involved in that plan. And so that's how we can be involved and also use, we've been given the words of life. Let's use them to preserve a culture, even though the culture does not want to hear the message. Have you ever had a conversation with somebody about God and you could just tell they're squirming in their seat? They don't want to hear anything you got to say. Plant the seeds. Let the Lord do the work. Amen? Pray and vote. It's all God's. So no matter who wins on November, whatever, it could get interesting if they, I don't know. Could we have a full-out war if Trump actually wins the election? These people have shown that they're capable of doing all kinds of things. But God is bigger than all of it, isn't he? Yep. Father, we are seeking your face. You see our world better than we see it. And Lord, we just ask that you would just help us, Lord. Help us just to keep seeking after you and keep doing the things you've asked us to do. And Lord, we know that you'll answer and bless in your time, however it is that you see fit. But we do pray for our nation, Lord. We pray that, well, first of all, let's pray for the church, that the church would repent from its entertainment, repent from not wanting to study your word, repent from definitely not wanting to study the Old Testament, repent from what many people might call boring Bible studies, repent from reading sections in Scripture that they would consider boring. Would your church, Lord, would you help us to repent from sins that we may have hidden in our hearts? And may revival take place within your church, because judgment begins in the house of God. And then we can successfully pray for revival to take place in our land. And we do, Lord. We pray earnestly. We pray for it. But our eyes are on you. They're upward. And so, Lord, help us to be faithful in the times which you've called us to live. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand. I don't know how they picked the songs, but got to be the Holy Spirit, right? Because we didn't design that or plan that. So praise, yeah, it just happened. So praise God. Hey, stay in the battle. It's His, right? We don't have to worry about it. And don't lose sleep, right? Like so far, we're prodigal sons. And all right, God bless. Hang out, fellowship. Oh, man.